morning, Destination Church. If you're able to stand with us, let's get ready to worship. We're going to declare that joy has a name. His name is Jesus. Let's sing.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and heaven and nature sing. We will sing, sing, sing. Joy to the world.
Joy to the world.
Joy to the world. The Savior reigns. Let men their songs employ. While fields and floods, rocks, hills, and plains repeat the sounding joy. Repeat the sounding joy. Sounding joy. We will sing, sing, sing.
Sing it out.
Joy to the world. We will sing, sing, sing.
Sing.
The world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness and wonders of his love and wonders of his love and wonders, wonders of his love. He will sing, sing, sing. Joy to the world. We will sing, sing, sing. Oh, joyful, joy.
Sing joyful, joyful.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, opening to the sun. Joyful, we adore thee, God
Come on, give me my hand clap this morning. Yes, and amen, and amen. So good to be with you today. Welcome to Destination Church. Welcome, DC Live. So good to have you online with us this morning. Just want to remind you today that the communion elements are ready for you. They've been blessed. They've been prayed over. And I want to just let you know as well that we are making this a part of our normal Sunday mornings, that communion will be available every Sunday. There'll still be Sundays, special Sundays, where we serve you communion, but the elements, along with a couple of other elements, will be available. Going into the new year, we'll bring some clarity to that and let you know about it. That's why you see these walls getting painted over and stuff up front. We're doing a little bit of change there, but just want to make you aware of that, that the elements will always be out. Anytime during worship, during our prayer times, you want to come up and get the elements, please make sure and, you know, do that. We'd love for you to partake of the elements, because there's so much power here, singing about the joy of the Lord this morning and joy to the world. The joy to the world is because Jesus came, right, the first time, that first Advent. You're going to hear more about Advent today, and that word is, it's just reflection, it's anticipating, it's waiting. And we know He came the first time, and with that, you know, with these elements we do have, if you're new to us, there's two little tabs on the communion elements. I just want to always point that out, because I've seen people get frustrated, right? You don't need to be frustrated in church. There's enough of that out there. And so you just pull one tab and then another. You'll see you get the bread and then the juice. But I want to remind you about that and let you know that. But we're so glad you're here. We'd ask this morning you just check your heart before you come partake of the elements. The scripture's clear on, you know, having stuff in here when you're rejoicing at high levels with the King of Kings and to the King of Kings and Lord of Glory. And we're excited. We're about to go into a place of awesome worship. And so I hope you enjoy that today. And God bless you. And we love you. And we are very excited you're here in this series we're in called Away in a Manger. So God bless you this morning.
So we are taught that there's so many names for God. He's our Savior, He's our Comforter, He's our Deliverer. But this morning, we sing about Him being love. Sing with me this morning.
There's a space in every beating heart. There's a longing that reaches past the stars. There's an answer to every question mark. There's a name. There's a hope flowing through these veins. There's a voice that echoes through the pain. There's an ember ready for the flame. There's a name. We will fix our eyes on the one who overcame. We will stand in awe of the one who breaks the chains. Love has a name. Love has a name. Jesus. Love has a name, love has a name, Jesus. There's a joy that triumphs over fear. There's a laughter that wipes away all tears. There's a presence that changes atmosphere. There's a name. We will fix our eyes on the one who overcame. We will stand in awe of the one who breaks the chains. Love has a name. Name Jesus.
proclaim it this morning. We will stand in awe of him.
We will stand in awe of the one who breaks the chains.
Oh, we fix our eyes.
We will fix our eyes on the one who overcame.
We didn't have to do a thing, Jesus.
We will stand in awe of the one who breaks the chains.
Sing it one more time.
We will fix our eyes on the one who overcame. Come and be
chapter 1, 46 to 55. This is the song of Mary. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham, and to his descendants forever.
We light this candle to symbolize love. We love because God first loved us. We love because one of the names God claims is love itself. We love because the whole of creation is echoing God's love over and over. May the God of love come among us once more this season. We light this candle not to drown out the darkness, but to illuminate what we have to learn from it. O come, Emmanuel. Loving God, what an incredible thing it is that you love every single part of your creation, including each of us. Help us to mirror your love toward everyone that we meet. In your name, the name of love, we pray. Amen.
Joy to be with you today. I love this season. I was thinking first service, I wasn't raised in a Christian home, and so I remember my first Christmas as a Christian more so than anything else. I was raised in a good home. I was raised in a home that celebrated Christmas, but it didn't have Jesus in it. And so when I celebrated my first Christmas with Jesus in it, I'll never ever forget what it was like. And so I don't know where you are in this today, and I don't know, you know, what it's like for you, and I don't know if you've ever given your life to Jesus, but man, there is nothing like celebrating Christmas time, knowing that Jesus Christ is the Lord of your life, and you'll get to spend eternity with him in heaven. And when we're singing these songs and working through it, I've been a Christian now for some 32 years, and I just love this Advent season and everything it represents, and I love it's a time the world is speeding up, but we slow down and we reflect and we anticipate the coming, the second coming of this great King. And so this morning, as we look at this and we sing this very familiar hymn to both the church and the world as well, because we can start singing it out in a city park and people will start singing it with us, I need you to understand it wasn't just something that was pulled out of thin air. That Psalm 95 is very clear on this hymn. And the psalmist would tell us in verse 1 of Psalm 95, O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into His presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise with Him with this song of praise. And you know, and if you skip over to verse 6, it's where the culmination of the song really comes from. The writer of this song some 200 years ago wrote this song, and so the church picked it up, and we've been singing it now for some 200 years, right? That's pretty powerful. He says, "Oh, come, let us worship and bow down, and let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for He is our God, and we are the people of His pasture, and the sheep of His hand." And I love this very last little ending, and I don't know who it's for today, but it's for somebody. It goes like this: today, if you hear His voice, my goodness, do not harden your heart. Do not harden your heart. And so I'm believing for soft hearts today when the Word of God is brought in this house. And I just thank you so much for being with us today. It's almost like, because we're going to just go back in one more time just for a moment. You know, with this particular song, this invitation to come all ye faithful to Bethlehem. So like this places us, the singers, it actually places us, among the shepherds who rushed to see the Christ child. And you're going to get to hear about that today. And in the long procession of the faithful for over 2,021 years, the people that have given their lives and through persecution and all the other things that have happened, it's all about, oh, come, right, in this faithful journey that we've been on. And so my prayer for you today is that your heart would stay soft as the message is brought, and you would receive this Jesus that I received some 32 years ago, and you could experience Christmas like I did on my very first Christmas. I love you, DC. You're so amazing. I love you online, guys. And this morning, let's just step back in right here, real quick, worship team, and just sing with all of your heart today. Thank you so much for allowing us to be in your presence with your people and worship, Father God, and just sing praises and glory to your name. Father, I ask today, God, that you would just come and have your way with us. Lord, that you would make our hearts an open place for you to come. And Lord, that we would receive you in all your fullness today. God, I just thank you so much for being so good to us. And what better season than Christmas to perform a miracle in this house? A house of miracles. It's your house, God. It's a house of miracles. And so I pray today for those that are believing by faith for you to do a miracle, that today is the day that a miracle is done in their life, in their marriage, in their finances, in their homes, with their kids and their kids' kids, and whatever it looks like. Father, I thank you for that this morning. Oh, how we love you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen and amen. Just for a moment, I want to let you know today, as you're preparing your hearts to receive the word, and we're in this awesome series called Away in a Manger. We have like 5 different communicators in this series, and so this morning you're going to get to hear from one of Renee and I's best friends, You're going to get to hear from Beth Taylor. She and her husband Eddie moved back here about 3 months ago, and it's been really neat to have them back with us in the city of Waycross and to have their ministry move back here. And so it's going to be an amazing time. She's going to step out and bring the word, just so you know that. But I also want to let you know that you're about to see a video about what's happening tonight at Destination Church at 6:30. And, you know, as we are doing something brand new called Christmas City. And so as you're being seated this morning, eyes on the video and tell somebody around you, everyone counts, especially you. Come on, tell somebody this morning, everyone counts, especially you.
Hey, Destination Church. My name is Justin Finley. I'm the children's pastor here. I want to take a moment to invite you to our first ever event to help you and your families kick off the Christmas season. Now, we're calling it Christmas City. We'll start off with some caroling, move into some games, and then we have our own take of our Christmas tree trail, where we're going to show you and your family how different countries all around the world celebrate Christmas. Especially the countries that we support in missions. We're so excited to show you all that goes on. Now, the event is starting on December 5th at 6:30 p.m. So, 'tis the season to invite your friends and come on down here at Destination Church where we can kick off the Christmas season together. We're so excited to join with you in this event. We look forward to seeing you there.
Good morning.
Yes.
Good morning. How are y'all doing? We had some technical difficulties first service. It's all right. But let's go ahead and get the elephant out of the room. There's a lot of mustaches that are showing up at Destination Church, and I'm not sure if that's good or bad, but we're so glad you're here. My name is Rick Clark, and me and my wife, Patty, we serve on the Dream Team here, and it's just such an honor. We're so glad you chose Destination to come and worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords this morning. We just have just a few little announcements. When you walked in, you got to worship God. And in that worship God, you've got two inserts that have so much information on what's going on here at Destination Church. So please look through it, not during the message, but look through it, see what's going on. If you're a first-time guest, on the side, there's a purple card that says connection card. We would love for you to fill that out and turn in our guest services desk, and you'll receive a free gift. We want to say good morning to DC Live. We're so glad you're joining us this morning. Our online pastor is on there. There's a link. Also, if you're a first-time guest, join us online. Click that link. Follow the instructions. Everything we take care of for you. So, first off, like Justin said, we got Christmas City kicking off tonight. You get to travel around and look at the different Christmas trees and how they serve, you know, how they do Christmas over there. We also have our Christmas Eve service coming up December the 24th. We've got two services, so please, we would love for you to RSVP. So you can either scan the QR code, or if you don't have a smartphone, you just call the office and we'll make reservations for you. We're in a series called, I always got this wrong, Away in a Manger is how I always thought it was. And when I was in elementary school, that, you know, you do your spelling test and you have manger and manager, but Away in a Manger, and it's such a good series. Here at Destination Church, we have multiple ways you can give your tithes and offerings. You can go online and give to destination-church.org. You can text the tithe. You can go to our Vanco app. You can also take the envelope that's in front of you. You can drop your cash money order in there and put it in these gray boxes called our cheer boxes. We make that sound because God has called us to be a cheerful giver, and we get to give back what is already His. Also, we have giving kiosks in the foyer, so you can go out there and swipe your debit card. At this time, we would love for you to stand up, and we're going to go ahead and pray over the rest of the service and this white Christmas that we have up here. Somebody's cotton field is missing a lot of cotton, but that's our Georgia snow that we have for right now. We're so grateful. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you so much. God, we thank you that this season is just arriving, waiting for you to show up, and you just show up in the mess. Lord, and this morning as we hear about love and compassion, God, that your mom had and that she was with you through every stage of your life. God, just to see those tears and those aha moments that Mary had, Lord, we get to feel that and see that this morning, Lord. Father, we ask that you bless the tithes and offerings, Lord. Bless the rest of this service, Lord, as your spirit is welcome in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. You got about 2 minutes to meet and greet.
You can come in. He won't bite. He's just a small baby. A little shy? That's okay. I am too. Your friends left in such a rush to go tell the world. I think that's how they put it. And what a thing to tell. Did you know an angel visited me too? It's true. And he said that my boy would be great. The Son of God. He said that he would be the King of angels. The King of all. Do you think that they'll understand? Do you think that they'll come to worship him? Will they accept him? Just look around us. It's not exactly a palace, is it? Noisy animals. Hay, out of all things for a bed. And that stench. For everything that he is. Maybe this isn't enough. I find myself just watching him. Adoring him. I thought I knew what love was. until he came along. My mother gave this blanket to me when I was just a little girl, a gift of love. I wore it out. When we were preparing for the trip to Bethlehem, I told Joseph I wanted to bring it. No, he said. We must pack light. I brought it anyway. The baby needs a blanket. Yes, they will come. The faithful. How could they not? He was born the King of Angels. He will be great and mighty. He is all this and more. But when you go tell my young friend, be sure to tell them that he is an incredible gift of love.
And that's the fourth time I've seen it, and I've cried again. Wow, an incredible gift of love. Hey, Destination family. Destination online, hi to you. I am so honored to be on this stage. I'm always honored to be on this stage, but a couple of months ago, Eddie and I relocated back to our hometown of Waycross, Georgia, moved our ministry here, and now this is our home. And so we became the richest people in the world. We love being a part of this family, and we are so grateful to be a part of this community. So Advent, wow. I grew up, Christmas was a huge deal in our family, and we celebrated it big. My grandfather adored Christmas, and it was huge. And but I was an adult before I began to have some understanding of Advent and the hush and the calm, which is so contrary to the hustle and bustle that, you know, and the busyness that I was raised in. And that was fun and good. But Advent is this dazzling tapestry of remembrance and anticipation. And when we think back to that, when Jesus showed up on the stage of human history, a scandalous presentation he made because he didn't show up as the mighty military leader that Israel was looking for to save them from the tyranny of Rome. He showed up as a baby in diapers. He showed up to save us from the tyranny of sin and to usher in his kingdom, just so much greater than anything Israel could have built, Rome could have built, or any of us here in the United States could ever build. His kingdom come, his will be done. That's what it's about. And then we celebrate in Advent with anticipation the return of our King. And we don't know when, we don't know how. No one knows. But we know he's coming back for a bride, for us. We are the bride. He's coming back, the scripture says, for a bride that's without spot, wrinkle, or blemish. And we're not there yet. Boy, we're not there yet, but we're going to get there. I feel like God put me in the earth to help clean up the bride, to help push her into his lap, into this place of intimate connection with the Father. And I'm part of that bride. I need that every day. And so as we move forward in our Away in a Manger series last week, all about hope, and the prophet Isaiah, in anticipation of what was coming. Johnny did a great job. It was beautiful. This morning we're talking about love. And we're going to see how love manifests itself in and through a little teenage girl named Mary. Did you know that before Isaiah, the Lord gave us a little hint about what was to come back in Genesis? In Genesis chapter 3, God declared war on Satan and gave the first promise of the Redeemer. Satan would bruise Christ's heel, but Christ would bruise Satan's head and defeat him. It says in Genesis 3:15, "And I will make enemies of you and the woman, and of your offspring and her descendant. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel." See, God, knowing for all time, had a plan at the beginning of mankind to repair the breach that man created between himself and God. In cloaked terms, he actually told the first Adam about the second Adam, who would restore the connection to the Father that the first Adam destroyed through his choice to sin and her choice to sin. And why? Why? Because he loves us so much. He loves us so much. And we sing about it growing up. Yeah, right. God loves me. Whatever. No. If we really understood and functioned from that place of being the beloved and understanding what that means for us, it would change the landscape of your life. It changes everything. In Isaiah 7:14, which we heard last week, Isaiah says, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and she will name him Emmanuel." Throughout Scripture, God is saying, "I'm coming. I'm coming for you." See, all through the Old Testament, it's just if you don't mind me doing some crude nutshelling here, the Old Testament is the story of how we blew it royally in the Garden of Eden. Eden means pleasure. It was his great pleasure to be connected with us. Unbroken, unprotected intimacy with the Lord. And when we mess that up, in the Old Testament, we just see the history of man trying to keep rules, making sacrifices with animals and all the things. And none of it's good enough, because there has to be the ultimate sacrifice. And God knew that all along. And then, right here where we are, what we're celebrating right now, the coming of the King. God comes in flesh and blood, and he shows up in our mess. And he says, "I love you with an everlasting love. I loved you before the garden, and I love you now." What sacrifice, what love. So let's look in Luke chapter 1. We're going to read verses 26 through 28, 30 through 33, and verse 38. "Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city in Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the descendants of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. And coming in, he said to her, 'Greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you.' And the angel said to her, 'Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and give birth to a son, and you shall name his name Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. And his kingdom will have no end.' And Mary said, 'Behold, the Lord's bondservant. May it be done to me according to your word.' And the angel departed from her." That's surrender right there, friends. We understand that Mary was probably about 13. Bible scholars, you study the culture of the day. Girls were often betrothed. We had arranged marriages then. And girls were often betrothed to be married 12, 13, 14 years old. So we know Mary was young. Do you remember being 13? Wow. I can't imagine what that must have been like. And it's so easy to read these accounts of Scripture. We read them over and over again, and we should, but they become like wallpaper to us. We know what's coming next, and we know how it ends. And so we read it, and we think, yeah, this happened, and this happened, and this happened. But we forget that these were human beings, real human beings, flesh and blood, ordinary people, living in an extraordinary time and dealing with remarkable circumstances. So your soul tattoo this morning is, Mary was the ordinary place where heaven and earth met. I am Mary, and you are Mary. We are where God still chooses for heaven and earth to show up. Mary was this ordinary teenage girl of humble means. She was a little peasant girl. She didn't come from money. She didn't come from anywhere fancy. She came from a little nowhere place like Nazareth. Have you ever been told you came from a little nowhere place like Waycross? I have. Maybe you've said it. But you know, God does some of his best work in nowhere places. He chose to show up on the stage of human history in a nowhere place in diapers. Come on. This is our King. This is our Father. And Mary was just an ordinary girl. Why would he do this? Because of his great love for us. And I think it's really important to emphasize the ordinary humanity, Mary's ordinary humanity, because it's this love-drenched backdrop for the greatest miracle this planet's ever seen. If she was some queen, or she was royalty, or she was anything fancy or supernatural, well, that's what people were expecting, wasn't it? But God shows up in ways that humans don't expect. Mary was the coordinate on the map of human history where heaven's love showed up. Every detail of his arrival drips with humility and stands in stark contrast to the man's religious expectations of how he would come. And I love that about him. I love that. Religious tradition be hanged, I'm going to show up the way I want to because I made this joint. This is my land. This is my home, and you are my people. And I'm coming for you, and it's going to surprise you. And Mary was just a girl. Every Mary moment in Scripture pointed to Jesus. I went back through and I looked at every Mary moment, and there were a handful of them. Where do your moments point? Where do the Beth moments point? Where do the Rodney and Renee moments point? Where? Well, let me just walk you through some of Mary's. So, her encounter with Gabriel. If that didn't point to Jesus, I don't know what does. And she listened and she acquiesced. Her encounter with Jesus at his birth in Bethlehem. We saw that on the screen. She looked at him and she loved him and she adored him. What about Mary's encounter with Elizabeth? So, I didn't read it here, but in that same account in Luke, Gabriel tells Mary that Elizabeth has also been visited and that she is with child in her 6th month. And she was barren, so this was a miracle. And why on earth would Gabriel go out of his way to tell her that? Well, the first thing that Scripture records that Mary did after she finished her encounter with the angel is she packed her bags and she went to where God had done another miracle. And she went to Elizabeth, her cousin. And that encounter with Elizabeth pointed straight to Jesus, because when she walked in, Elizabeth said, "What did I do to deserve this visit from the mother of my Lord?" She knew that God was up to something. There was such an expectation in the air then. And then her worship after that, what does she do? She worships God, and she worships the Lord that she's carrying in her womb. She worships God. She goes where God had been at work, and then she worships him. Points straight to Jesus. What about her encounter with the adolescent Jesus in the temple? You guys ever had a teenage kid? I have had 3. And sometimes they don't show up where they're supposed to. Sometimes they go where you don't think they're going to go. But he looked at his mother and he said, "I was about my father's business." He knew as a young boy who he was. And she knew too. What about her intervention at the wedding in Cana? Jesus had not performed a miracle yet. He was gathering his disciples to himself, and people were beginning to hear about him. And when they ran out of wine, Mary goes to Jesus and says, "You can fix this." And he looks at her and says, "But my time has not yet come." And I love, she did what any good parent of an adult child would do. She just turned to the servants and says, you do whatever he says to do. And then she got out of the way. That's a wise mother. But sometimes mamas kind of know something, don't they? And then he turned the water into wine and performed this incredible miracle that set the stage for a lot of beauty and a lot of heartache. What about her presence at the foot of the cross? This pointed directly to Jesus. She was there. Scripture records her presence at the death of her son. Can you imagine watching your child die a cruel and heinous death at the hands of the Romans, the people that have taken over your land? Wow. And then she shows up in the book of Acts, waiting in the upper room with the disciples. Because Ernest Hemingway once wrote that every true story ends in death, but not this one. Amen. Not Jesus' story. And she knew it. She was in the upper room with the disciples, and she was waiting for her boy to show back up. Whatever that was going to look like, she knew. And they were waiting. Every Mary moment in Scripture pointed to Jesus. Her very existence revolved around his. She lived a life marked by her love for him. This is the pattern. This is what I'm showing you all this morning, that everything about Mary revolved around Jesus. And you're Mary, and I'm Mary. And that's what we were put in the earth for. And when we settle for less than that, we rob ourselves of unspeakable treasure and beauty that God created, that the first man and woman knew in that Garden of Eden, the Garden of Pleasure, the place of intimate connection. So, as we focus on love this morning, let's take a look at a few lessons that we can glean from Mary's life of love for Jesus. Number one, Mary's life purpose was to bring forth the life of Christ. To bring forth the life of Christ. And so is yours. And so is yours. We were created to know and love him. That's what we were made for. We were made to love him and be loved by him. And when we blew that in the garden, then it became important for us to express who Jesus is in the earth, because there are lost and dying people who need to know him. And so our purpose has become to love him and to make him known in the earth. In John 10, verses 30 and 31, Jesus, adult Jesus, is talking to a group of Jewish believers. And he's talking about his oneness with God. And when he gets to the end, he says, I and the Father are one. And then the Jews picked up their stones again to stone him. We don't like it when God colors outside the lines of our careful religious constructs. We can't stand it. We want things to be the way we've been taught that they are. But I've come to learn as an adult Christian that a lot of the things that I've been taught as a younger adult Christian were traditions of men. Had nothing to do with what God's doing in the earth. And so I want to read the scripture for what the scripture really says. And the scripture really says that Jesus and the Father were one. And that Christ is in us. So we are one with them. Jesus lived and modeled oneness with his Father. This level of love always offends religion. Always. Have you ever been offended by the passion you've seen in someone else? It's religion inside of you that's offended. It's your flesh that's saying, man, I wish I had that. And you can. Oh my goodness. We can all have this. It's what we were made for. And then Paul goes on. Let's move on into the New Testament a little more. Paul, the murderer of Christians, who was apprehended by the Lord, who surrendered himself to him, and who gave his life over for the cause of the gospel. Paul is talking to the church in Colossae, and he is expressing that Jesus is the exact representation of the Father. And he says this in Colossians 1, 25 through 27. I was made a minister of this church according to the commission from God granted to me for your benefit, so that I might fully carry out the preaching of the word of God. That is the mystery, which has been hidden from the past ages and generations, but now has been revealed to his saints, to whom God willed to make known what the wealth of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles is, and the mystery that is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Christ in you. See, Jesus stood up and said, I and the Father are one. And if Christ is in you, then the Father is in you. And the Holy Spirit is there for us should we choose to receive him and the power of the Spirit to walk this thing out. He didn't leave us with no gas in the car to push all over our life. He gave us the fuel of the Holy Spirit to empower us for this. It takes him to love him. We don't love him because we're so great. The scripture says we love because he first loved us. 1 John 4:19. And so he's the initiator and we respond. Or do we? That's the choice we have. Mary chose to respond. Christ in you. Mary literally carried the physical incarnation of Christ in her body. And we carried the crucified and risen Christ in us through the power and presence of Holy Spirit. We do. That's who we are. That's a powerful call on our life to carry that. Galatians 2:20, this is probably my favorite scripture in the whole Bible. It's my life verse. Galatians 2:20 says, I've been crucified with Christ and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me. Gave himself for me. I've been crucified with Christ and I no longer live. Is that the reality of your life? Is that the reality of mine? Or do we bring our hopes and dreams before God and say, bless them, Lord. I want to do this. God, bless this. Provide for this. When what he wants is ownership, Christ in you, I no longer live. If I no longer live, then he should be living through me. In me, around me, out of me. Every decision I make, every motive of my heart is influenced by that connection with the Father. This is how Jesus lived. Connection, oneness, all that was lost through the actions of the first Adam and was restored through the actions of the second. We were made for oneness with God. The second life lesson, from Mary's life of love. Not only was her life purpose to bring forth the life of Christ, but Mary lived with the consequences of his favor. Mary chose to live with the consequences of his favor. Now, let me unpack this for you a little bit. You might find this shocking, but God's favor doesn't always feel good. It doesn't always look good. Gabriel comes to Mary, remember, and says, greetings, favored one, the Lord is with you. This is how Gabriel begins his encounter with Mary. But what does favor look like? Let's look and see what favor looks like for Mary. Well, she's an unmarried pregnant teenager. The favor of the Lord has come upon her. To be an unmarried pregnant teenager right now is a challenge for a family, for sure. But an unmarried teenager in her time, in her culture, no. Women were property. They didn't own anything. They had no way to support themselves and feed themselves, so they depended on a husband. And if that husband then died, then hopefully his brother would marry her and take care of her and her children. And so Mary knew that she may also, and this is the second little piece of favor that she walked in, facing the shame of Joseph's possible rejection. Because by law, he could put her away and choose not to marry her, even though they were betrothed. She was pregnant, and not from him, not by him. The favor of God. Being massively misunderstood and misrepresented. I mean, sure, the virgin birth had been spoken about by the prophet Isaiah, right? But Mary, a peasant girl from Nazareth? Nah, that can't be. That can't be. A journey to Bethlehem. This is my favorite. the favor of God gave her a journey to Bethlehem that took 4 or 5 days in her last trimester on a donkey or a horse or some other beast of burden. Sign me up. I had 3 babies, and I can tell you in the last trimester, I didn't want a 5-day car trip. I can't even imagine what this must have been like. But you know what it was for her? This was the favor of God. What about giving birth in a stable? Fresh. It's good stuff right there. Just give birth with the pigs and the horses and whatever else is in there. The favor of the Lord. And then what about when Jesus was a few days old and Joseph and Mary take him to the temple for dedication. And Anna and Simeon, both prophets of the Lord, have been waiting for the Christ child to show up, for the Messiah. Simeon holds the baby and prays and blesses that baby and prophesies. And part of that painful prophecy of Simeon in regard to Jesus' destiny was that her soul would be pierced. So while he's still in a baby in diapers, and they didn't have diapers, baby diapers, she knew that her future was going to have pain in it. The favor of the Lord. What about fleeing to Egypt? There's another fun road trip with her baby to protect him from death, because the king wanted to kill all the babies so they could make sure he got rid of Jesus. Can't have another king. Not a good thing. Herod was threatened. The favor of the Lord. What about losing your kid for 3 days at the Passover feast in Jerusalem? I mean, we usually did a head count when we traveled, but something happened, and but he was about his father's business. He was. The favor of the Lord. Witnessing. What about this? Witnessing the respected religious leaders of the day hate and ridicule her son. That couldn't have felt like favor. That couldn't have. And when she stood at the foot of her son's cross, was that the favor of the Lord? You bet. You bet. Sometimes the favor of God doesn't look pretty. Eddie and I planted a church a thousand years ago, and it was not a grand success. And it lasted 3 years, and then it died a painful death. It was a hard season. It's a very hard season for two pastors with 3 little kids and just doing our best to follow God. And one of our mothers in the Lord was talking to us sometime shortly after that, and she said, you know, you and Eddie walk in so much favor. You just have the favor of the Lord all over you, all over your life. I mean, except for that time when your church failed and you had to close that. But other than that, you guys have had an immense amount of favor. And I looked at her because I knew her heart. I knew what she was saying. It didn't look like favor. And I looked at her and I said, oh, that was favor. That was the favor. That was the kiss of God. We needed that failure. Our flesh needed that. That was God loving us enough to let us walk through a dark place. That is favor. Favor isn't always pretty, and it doesn't always feel good. And sometimes you feel like God's abandoned you. There had to have been beautiful, soul-soaring moments as well for Mary. I mean, she looked straight into the eyes of God, for goodness sakes. Who else has done that? She held him. She kissed his face. She nourished the Savior of all mankind at her teenage breast. Oh, my word. That had to feel like favor. She was there to witness his first miracle in Cana. Those tiny hands that once grasped her fingers turned water into wine, thus bringing attention to for the first time to who he really was. She was there to see that. Those little feet that kicked inside of her would walk on water and trample all over religious tradition. Favor. But his favor isn't always easy, and it doesn't always appear like favor. When the life of Christ shows up in your everyday, it can be beautiful and peaceful and elating, but it can also be lonely and empty and painful feeling. It can even look like God is opposing you. That's why we don't focus on what life looks like. We look at what he looks like. And he looks like love, unfailing, unclenching, never-ending love. We don't train our eyes on the facts, my friends. We train our eyes on the truth. And truth is a person, the man Christ Jesus. Love is a person, the man Christ Jesus. Birth is messy, guys. But the life of Christ is worth the mess. It was worth it for Mary. And it's worth it for you and for me. His love for us made the pain of our redemption worth his pain. Not our love for him that made it worth the pain. His love for us made that redemption worth the pain. And his love for us makes walking in surrender to him worth it. It always, always, always goes back to love. So the third lesson from Mary's life of love for Jesus. Love is a choice. Mary could have said no, and so can you. See, we often forget that the conception of Jesus didn't happen to Mary. It was offered to her. It didn't just happen to her. It was offered to her. Most people read this passage of Scripture and assume that the King of Kings took Mary for his own purpose, just like an earthly king would take yet another woman into his harem for his own pleasure and his own purpose. Not so. Not so. Not once in human history has God ever forced himself on humanity. I dare you to find it in Scripture. I dare you. Not once has he forced himself on humanity. We've always had a choice. Instead, he offers himself. He just puts himself out there. He says, "Will you have me?" And at the one moment in history where he shows up dressed in flesh and bone, he offers himself once again, yet ultimately. All of heaven, wrapped in skin, made a choice to surrender his life in exchange for ours. And once again, there's a choice. Will we surrender to him with all that we are? Or will we settle for this distant view with little to no buy-in? I go to church. I love God. I pray and ask him to bless me, bless my family, bless my plans, bless my finances. But where's the oneness? Where is what he paid for? Where is what he paid for? So many of us settle for living a life of praying the prayer, "Jesus, help me." Is it wrong to ask God to help you? Certainly not. But I like to think that as we grow up in him, we come to a place where we stop saying, "Jesus, help me," and we say, "Jesus, have me. Have me." He didn't come to this earth in flesh, in a diaper, to grow up and give his life at Calvary's knee so that we could have a helper. It's so that he could own us, so that he could have what he made. He bought and paid for us. And we're the ones that messed it up back in the beginning. We're the ones that traded pleasure for knowledge. Sometimes we still do. And yet Jesus said, "I came. I came for you. I didn't come to make your life better. I came to own your life, to live my life through your life. Christ in you, the hope of glory." If we go back to Genesis, Let's go back to Genesis chapter 3. See God reaching out to mankind. Genesis 3, 8 and 9. "Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to them and said, 'Where are you? Where are you?'" Y'all all know God knew where they were, right? Y'all know that? Spoiler, God knew exactly where they were. He knows everything. He asked this question to punctuate the distance that they had created between themselves and him so that they could see what they had done. For God to have to ask, "Adam, where are you?" When all they had known is oneness. All they had known. So then God began his journey to close the distance that we had created and repair the breach. It began in that first garden, and it culminated in the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus breathed out, "Not my will, but yours be done." on his knees, his disciples napping in the background because they couldn't keep their eyes open, and Jesus is in more pain than he had known up to that point. Not my will, but yours be done. That sounds startlingly, I should have chosen a different word. Startlingly. That sounds startlingly close to the prayer his mother prayed, right? When she says, may it be to me according to your word. Maybe he was a little bit like his mama too. But he was most definitely like his father. Will we gaze on him? Did you catch that in that video? When she's talking to that little shepherd boy? Mary says, I find myself gazing on him and loving him. My goodness. Isn't that really why we live? We have our businesses and our classrooms and our work that we do. When someone asks you, walks up to you, they don't say, who are you? They say, what do you do? Our identity is what we do. That's how we've become. That's what we've become. So what do you do? Well, I own my own business, and I didn't even have a good example ready. But anyway, that's what I do. I do this or I do that. I'm a teacher. I'm a nurse. I'm a stay-at-home mom. I'm a stay-at-home dad. I'm all these things. No. That's what you do. Who you are is the son or a daughter of the Most High King. You're a lover and a gazer. That's what you are. And when you do all the loving and the gazing, not being able to take your eyes off him, then that flows out of you when you're out there doing the doing. We have to come to a place where we stop saying, God, help me with what I'm doing, and say, God, have me so I can help you with what you are doing in the earth. Because it's about your purposes in the earth. Because see, our purposes will burn up. There will be nothing. But his purposes are eternal. It will carry on into eternity. Every moment that we partner with him, we are partnering with eternity. We're making a difference for someone else's eternity. Every moment. Isn't that our highest calling? Isn't that why we were created? Mary was the place on earth that love showed up. You're Mary. And I'm Mary. And it's a high privilege to be Mary. But we can tell him no. And some of us do every day. Tell him no. No, you can't show up in my life. No, you can't demonstrate who you are through my life. I'm busy demonstrating who I am. And heaven weeps because we aren't living up to our potential. We're not living up to what we were created for. We are the vessels chosen to bring forth the Savior in the earth today. And how are we going to respond? Why don't we pray? Father, your faithfulness is astounding. All of human history, when we've been faithless, when we've failed, when we've not shown up, when we've not allowed you to have your way, you continue to show up and you continue to be who you are. You're faithful to your nature. You are love and you are truth and you are good. Even when everything around us screams that you are not good. Throughout human history, you've taken the blame for all the things that aren't your fault, but they're ours. But Lord, this morning we're going to look to you. We're going to look to you this morning and hear your call to come up higher, to live from a place of intimate connection with you, of love, of oneness, of saying, God, have me. Have me. Have all of me. My past, my present, my future, my children, my career, my goals and my dreams, my money, where I live, my body. Have it, Lord. It's all yours. we need you. Just like the Jews in that early, all those years ago, waiting for you to show up. And you did. And now you're just waiting for us to show up and allow you to be who you are through us. So we say yes to you this morning, Lord. We say yes. We say yes. Thank you, Jesus. If you're here this morning and you don't know the Lord, maybe this is a Christmas, just like all the ones in the past, where Jesus is not your companion. He's not your best friend. He's not your Savior and your Lord, because you haven't given yourself to Him. And you'd like to do that for the first time, our prayer team's going to be down here. Please come and let us pray for you. Don't have another Christmas. Don't have another Christmas without Him. And if you're here this morning and your heart is crying out for something that you've never really known, that oneness with Him, maybe you've spent your whole life praying, Jesus, help me. But now this morning you're ready to say, Jesus, have me. Come down this morning. Let someone pray for you. Let this be your best Advent ever. Lord, give your children courage this morning to surrender to you. You surrendered to your Father's will, and we surrender to yours this morning, Lord. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Can you give Beth a hand this morning? Thank you so much. Let's go ahead and stand up. We're getting ready. We're going to worship one more song together. We intentionally, our services are changing it a little bit. And so I'm excited this morning to be able to close out in song. Our prayer team is up front. Remember, Jesus, have me. It's okay to say, Jesus, help me. But man, if you pray, Jesus, have me first, come on. I mean, it's so powerful. I was thinking this morning, you know, I don't know why, just through the years, it seems like the altar is like a weird place to come to. And one of the things that we've done is tried to make the altar the best place to come to. Because when you're out there, it's about I. But when you're up here, it's about we. And what we know is that we're better together. And so this morning, you know, whatever's going on, whatever you need prayer for, if you need prayer, that's why the team's up front. They're up here to pray for you. And so as they start singing this morning, just, you know, Jesus, have me. Jesus, have me today. Whatever you've got for me. And so let's just worship for a few moments, and then I'll come back up and close us out in prayer. And give us just a couple of closing announcements today. But hey, let's worship the Lord, church.
Thank you.
worthy of it all.
You're worthy of it all. You're worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
Amen and amen. Come on, one more big time. Just one big round of applause for the King of Kings and the Lord of Glory. Thank you for being with us this morning. I want to remind you of a couple of things. Number one, we are having a baby dedication for some babies at 1 o'clock today. And those parents and families know you are. So we're excited about that. If you want to hang out and be a part of that, we'd love to have you there. Number two, at 6:30 this evening, we're doing, a brand new event for us called Christmas City, and we're very excited about it, and it's going to be a great evening, a fellowship, a great time of, there's going to be some singing and some other stuff going on with our student ministry. So grateful for Justin and his team for bringing that to us, and we're excited about that. Just want to say to you today as you leave, I hope this song resonates in your heart all week long. He is worthy of it all. And I hope night and day, day and night, that even if you get up in the middle of the night, that you're worshiping this King that we serve. His name is Jesus. And I hope you have a wonderful week and you're able to share this love that Beth talked about all morning long with people out there, not just people in here. We're called to go, right, church? And so God bless you. We love you. Have a wonderful, wonderful day. Enjoy this beautiful South Georgia weather. So God bless you, church. We love you. And remember, if you're a guest with us today, just turn in that connection card. We want to connect with you. Worship team is still going to be singing. Prayer team will still pray for you this morning. Communion is here as well. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.